All the lights have been turned off, and you can see that it is glowing really bright.
Hi guys, you are watching channel Mr. Electron, and these what you see are a few 12 volts DC motors. Now, a DC motor is a variable current type of load, which means that the current keeps on changing as the load changes. Higher the load on the motor shaft, more is the current drawn by it. Next, what you see are a few incandescent bulbs, which come under the category of constant current type of resistive loads. And the final ones that you see are the constant voltage loads, which are our electronic circuits and batteries. Now guys, all the above loads are rated at 12 volts, but let's assume that I only have a 20 volts 3 amps DC source. Now, what will happen if I connect the previously shown loads to this higher volt supply? In case of the DC motors, their no load speed will increase because RPM is directly proportional to the input voltage. The impact will be its brushes will wear out faster than usual, its commutators will also wear out faster than usual. There is also going to be an additional heating which might affect the strength of magnets used in the motor. Now, let's consider the case of what will happen if we connect a 20 volts supply to a 12 volts 1 ampere bulb. The bulb will fuse instantly because more than rated current will flow through the filament and burn it. Now comes the final test of connecting the 20 volts 3 ampere power supply to a 12 volts electronic circuit or a 12 volts battery. Both of them will get damaged because the battery will get overcharged with time and the electronic circuits are too much voltage specific. So keeping all that in mind, we can conclude that we need to build a 12 volts circuit. Let's get started. First component is 13009 power transistor, second one is CTC1351, third one are diodes, Zener diodes, 1.8 volts each, and the fourth final one is 1 kilo ohm resistor, and final heat sinks and few wires. That's it. Now comes the construction of the circuit. Take the 13009 power transistor and bend its three terminals as shown. Next, do the same thing with the NPN1351 power transistor. Next comes the placing of thermal paste or heat sink compound on the power transistor. Okay, this is how it is going to transfer all the heat safely to the heat sink. Place it on both the transistors. Now comes the part of mounting the two transistors on the heat sink. So here, as you can see, that I'm going to use a single heat sink and I'm going to mount both the transistor on a single piece. You can use two heat sinks, separate heat sinks, for cooling it further, but I think it is not going to generate much of heat. Now take the two Zener diodes and shorten up their terminal ends by cutting them. After that, connect the two Zener diodes in series. Like, one Zener diode is at 1.8 volts. So if we connect two of them together in series, it's going to be 3.6 volts DC. Now take the positive end of the Zener diode and connect it to the base terminal of the 1351 power transistor. Now solder the base of 13009 power transistor to the emitter of 1351 power transistor. After that, take a wire and connect it to the emitter terminal of 13009 power transistor. Now comes the collector terminals of both the transistors. These two collector terminals will be soldered together, and this point is going to be the tapping point at which multiple connections will be made. Take another wire and connect it to the collector, common collector of both the transistors. Now bend the Zener diodes and connect their negative set to the collector as well. This is how you're going to do it. Now hold the green wire as shown here and place it through the screw hole of the heat sink. Now you will need another wire, a different colored one. Strip it and then place it through the other screw hole of the heat sink. Lastly, strip the two wires in the middle and connect the 1 kilo ohm resistor to the two wires. Please note that the links for all the needed components have been provided in the description. So don't forget to check them out if you really want to make this circuit.
So well done guys, it's finally time to test it. This is the laptop charger connected to the 220 volts supply. And this laptop charger is converting 220 volts AC to 20 volts DC. So what I'm going to do is convert that 20 volts DC to 12 volts DC. Although the output is going to be a little higher so that there is a charge difference and current can flow easily. And remember that this green wire here is positive and yellow one is negative. Red clip will be connected to the green because red is always denoted by positive. And yellow one will be negative, and we are done. Now let's do the measurement of output voltage first. So pointing the meter towards DC voltage measurement mode. Okay, you can see there is some voltage being deflected because of one wire connection. And now we have our full 13.09 volts DC out from the laptop charger by using just this circuit. No transformer is needed. All you gotta do is just do this. It is very simple and safe, and the output voltage is pretty accurate. So the voltage testing is done. Now comes the LED panel glowing test. So this is a 12 volts LED panel, and obviously it would have burnt out or got fused if I had connected this panel directly to the laptop charger, since this is 12 volts and this is 20 volts. So I have converted it safely to 12 volts. Let's see how it performs. And here we have 20 volts beautifully converted to 13 volts, exactly needed for this. Let's turn off the lights. All the lights have been turned off, and you can see that it is glowing really bright. And also there is negligible heating because this driving transistor is rated at 12 amperes and also connected to a good heatsink with heatsink compound or thermal paste. So it should not be a problem. Turned off the camera lights as well, and now it is even more bright. See, pretty good, right? So let's increase the loads now. This is a 12 volts 35 watts bike headlamp bulb. Let's try this one. Let's turn off the lights. You see, it is glowing pretty bright. Moving on to an even bigger bulb. You see, 12 volts 100 watts. That's big one for car headlamp. Let's turn off all the lights. Now guys, comes this high current DC motor. It is 12 volts, 5 amperes, really smooth. So let's test this one. Initially it was running on 20 volts, so the RPM was higher, but now it is running at the exact needed RPM. So guys, I have removed the jumper cables and I have connected the circuit directly to the laptop charger. Meter is showing 0 volts DC. And let's measure the battery voltage, which as you can see is around 12.54 volts. Now let's connect the jumper cables here and then see the change in voltage. At present it is 12.54 volts and you can see that it is safely increasing. And we can leave it like this.
So guys, your question for today is, what was the maximum RPM displayed by the tachometer in my previous project video?
Well guys, you can also carry out the same process on a 20 volts solar panel. Okay, that's the battery meter and my circuit. Here as you can see guys, that the voltage is increasing. 12.47, 48. And so on. So the increase in voltage is indicating here that the battery is charging with the solar panel, and it is really safe because this circuit is going to limit the output voltage to around 13.2 or 13.3 volts
DC. So you can even leave the battery so that it keeps on charging all the time, and when it is fully charged, then the current from the circuit is automatically going to reduce to zero.